The Godfather is my vote for the best film ever made, not counting its sequel, of course. It's the closest that I believe a film can get to being perfect in every facet of its production. But even when you put aside the iconic cinematography, the superb acting, and the beautiful score, its writing is second to none. It has great characters, great plot, great everything. Every single character is well written and much care was put into how they were written, no matter how significant they are in the film. In fact, here's one quick little example on the character of Carlo. Even before he starts abusing Connie, we see his anger towards her and even some dialogue setting up the relationship him and Sonny have.
Well, Papa never talked business at the table in front of the kids.
Hey, shut up, Connie. Don't you ever tell her to shut up. You got that?
It doesn't seem like a whole lot since it's not even the main thing that's supposed to be taken away from the scene. But then you realize what it's setting up. I'll be honest, I didn't even notice until my third viewing of the movie, and I'm sure that many have watched this film even more times without noticing. Today, I wanted to talk about one particular character. There's no denial that his effect on the plot is significant, but despite that, his time in the movie isn't very long, and he's not very highly regarded by people. Character in question is Virgil Salazzo, also known as the Turk. Salazzo is the main villain of the first act of the film, and he very much makes his mark. However, talk is cheap, so let's get right into this first scene, shall we?
Don Corleone, I need a man who has powerful friends. I need $1 million in cash. I need, Don Corleone, those politicians that you carry in your pocket, like so many nickels and dimes.
Right here, it's established that this character is a businessman. Basically, in the scene, Salazzo is cutting a deal with one of the main characters, Vito Corleone. He asks Vito for permission to use the connections he has with politicians for his own uses, as well as $1 million for finance. At the same time, he makes sure to outline his needs in a benevolent manner. Obviously, simply flattering Vito isn't going to heavily change his opinion, but it helps contribute, especially given how much Vito values respect.
But, now you come to me and you say, Don Corleone, give me justice. But you don't ask with respect. You don't offer friendship. You don't even think to call me Godfather.
Anyways, when Vito asks what the interest for the family is, Salazzo gives some big projections.
30%. In the first year, your end should be $3-4 million. And then it would go up.
Salazzo is likely telling the truth, but the point is that he's able to say all the right things. This aspect of his character becomes more apparent later on.
Now, what is the interest for the Tattaglia family?
The relations that Salazzo has with the Tattaglia crime family isn't supposed to be something that the Corleones are aware about. Regardless, Salazzo only needs a second to think of a way to clear things up.
My compliments.
First thing Salazzo does is turn to Vito's consigliere, Tom Hagen, and compliment him for finding out about his ties to the Tattaglias. Right afterwards, he continues to talk business to Vito.
I'll take care of the Tattaglias. Out of my share.
Every single thing this man says is with benevolence and respect, and the writers are worthy of praise for not letting up with how Salazzo acts in this scene.
You're a genius. Just, mwah, I kiss the feet. Mwah, I kiss the feet.
He is simply trying to use a degree of charisma in order to get the deal that he wants done. Still, Salazzo takes a second to prepare what he's going to say, betraying his unpreparedness.
Why do you come to me? Why do I deserve this generosity?
If you consider $1 million in cash, just finance. Disallowed, Don Corleone.
Salazzo responds playfully just to make it seem that Vito's question was irrational, but still sort of praising Vito for its wealth. It's a good line that shows how Salazzo is smooth and flattering with his words while still being factual, as a businessman should be. However, it's too late. The fact that Salazzo admitted that Tattaglia's involvement was already fishy, and as we're about to see, Vito already has his reasons for not getting into the drug business. Vito gets up from his seat, refills Salazzo's bottle, and sits closer to him. He proceeds to give Salazzo his decision.
I must say no to you, and I'll give you my reasons. It's true, I have a lot of friends in politics. But they wouldn't be friendly very long if they knew my business was drugs instead of gambling, which they regard as a harmless vice, but drugs is a dirty business.
Well, Don Corleone.
It doesn't make any difference to me what a man does for a living, I understand. But your business is... A little dangerous.
Vito Corleone came to America as a child orphan with next to nothing. At this point, he does everything he does because he loves his family and wants them to live happier and easier lives.
I work my whole life. I don't apologize to take care of my family.
He doesn't want to lose what he has, and he doesn't want his business to get dangerous for his children either. He sees the drug business as something that could jeopardize everything he's built up. He's busted his ass to get to this point in life, and he doesn't want it to come crashing down simply because of money. It's disagreeable from a logical perspective, but it's far from unreasonable. Politicians might object on both a moral and practical level, and by the end of the film, it is more than apparent that the drug business does pose a lot of danger. Later on, in fact, Vito says that he worries about how the narcotics business might affect the relationship between the five families.
When did I ever refuse? Except one time. And why? Because I believe this drug business is going to destroy us in the years to come.
Ultimately, Vito's right. Anyway, Salazzo acknowledges Vito's final grievance about the danger of the drug business.
If you're worried about security for your million, the Tatalis will guarantee it.
And at that point, Vito's son Santino can't help but ask more about what Salazzo claims due to it sounding like a perfect deal.
Oh, are you telling me that the Tatalis guarantee our investment?
It's perfectly in character for Sonny to ask that question. Even only up to this point, he's been repeatedly shown to be a short-sighted, impulsive person. On top of this, we see right before this scene that he's very much interested in getting into the drug business. So him being taken aback by the claim and instantly opening his mouth is totally in character, but it's also a foolish decision. As soon as Sonny is silenced, everybody else catches how foolish of a decision it was of Sonny to let his immediate emotions get in the way of simply listening. To the audience, it initially seems like a small blunder, but as we'll see, its effects are catastrophic. Besides, it's never a good idea to express your true thoughts in a business deal. As will be shown soon enough, Salazzo understands that better than anyone. Anyways, Vito does what every parent does and makes fun of their children's mistakes.
I have a sentimental weakness for my children, and I spoil them, as you can see. They talk when they should listen.
He then closes out with the usual all due respect and good luck thing and shakes hands. Then, once Salazzo leaves the room, Sonny is called over.
What's the matter with you? I think your brain is going soft.
And that closes out the first appearance of Salazzo in the film. What an appearance it is. Let's just jump straight into what his next actions are. Vito tells his right-hand man, Luca Brasi, to go get hired by the Tatalis to find out what their game is. Given that he doesn't already trust the demeanor of Salazzo, and perhaps not his claim about paying the Tatalis out of his own pocket, sending in a loyal henchman that won't be seduced by a large fee of money is a good move, even if the Tatalis find Luca's change of heart to be unlikely. As it turns out, they do. Salazzo has Luca killed. Even if he wasn't sure about Luca being undercover, still would have caused zero harm to kill Luca just to be safe. And of course, Salazzo knew that there was the possibility that Vito was onto him. So it's a smart move on Salazzo's part, and certainly in character. The next thing Salazzo does is find out from Vito's chauffeur where he usually goes in public. Salazzo then attempts to have Vito killed. It's by sheer luck that Vito doesn't die from this encounter. Not that this is faulting the movie. Vito getting shot is the inciting incident. There's no real problem if your story is started with a coincidence or good luck. Besides, this video is about Salazzo, and Salazzo has nothing to do with how good his assassins are at shooting. The next thing that Salazzo does is capture Tom Hagen.
What are you worried about? If I wanted to kill you, you'd be dead already.
Holy shit, that is a spicy line.
You're a genius, genius.
As I've said before, Salazzo only acted the way he did at the meeting for the sake of business. Right here, we see him talking completely differently. Business dictates that he scares Tom into submission. However, once he gets Tom back to the bar to talk to him, he goes back to being his usual kind self.
Your boss is dead.
Salazzo gets straight to the point this time around, being freed of the burden of having to mix in compliments to flatter such a powerful figure. Now he only has to convince Tom Hagen, the second in command, to talk sense into Sonny.
Sonny was hot for my deal, wasn't he? And you knew it was the right thing to do.
Salazzo didn't try to kill Vito out of hatred or even to send a message. He tried to kill Vito because he knew that Sonny had shown much interest in the deal. And with Vito dead, Sonny would become leader of the family business and would have power to accept Salazzo's deal. Needless to say, it's a ruthless yet smart move, which lines up with Salazzo's whole it's good business philosophy. Tom, knowing how impulsive and emotional Sonny is, tells Salazzo that Sonny's reaction won't be diplomatic at all.
Sonny will come after you with everything he's got.
That'll be his first reaction, sure. That's why you gotta talk some sense to him.
Now at this point, you may be thinking, what's gonna happen if Tom is turned loose and he helps out Sonny with the counterattack? Salazzo takes care of that by making sure to spell out just how big of a pickle the Corleone family is in.
The Tatalia family is behind me with all their people. The other New York families will go along with anything that'll prevent a full-scale war.
Fact of the matter is, if the Corleones don't take the deal, they are at extreme risk of getting completely dog-filed by all the other crime families. There is no safer option.
Let's face it, Tom, I'm all due respect. The Don, rest in peace, was slipping.
Salazzo at least says with all due respect to seem nice, but all that respect that was shown earlier was simply for show. Not that this line is supposed to be genuine either, all Salazzo is really trying to do is paint Vito as having made the wrong decision. So Salazzo finally gives his ultimatum to Tom.
So you gotta talk to Sonny, you gotta talk to the Cabo regimes, that Tessio, that fat Clemenza. It's good business, Tom.
At this point, Tom is dead to rights and accepts.
I'll try. But even Sonny won't be able to call off Luca Brasi.
Yeah. Well, let me worry about Luca.
Salazzo escorts Tom out and gives out one of my favorite lines from the movie.
I don't like violence, Tom. I'm a businessman. Blood is a big expense.
Such a great line. It's one of the few lines in the movie where Salazzo is totally telling the truth. It's true that most of the time assassinations provoke costly conflicts. Salazzo only chose to kill Vito because it was the only way to get funds and political influence needed for his operation, and he knew that the Corleones were cornered. Anyways, Salazzo takes Tom outside, and a man informs him of something.
He's still alive. They hit him with 5 shots and he's still alive.
Well, that's bad luck for me, and bad luck for you if you don't make that deal.
Salazzo's threats and persuasion work like a charm. Throughout all of Tom's conversations with Sonny, it's not hard to see that he's on edge and extremely worried.
Your father would want to hear this. This is business, not personal.
They shot my father.
It's business. Even the shooting of your father was business, not personal, Sonny.
And all of these scenes, it's so easy to empathize with either side of these arguments between Sonny and Tom. As Tom looks at the objective long-term result of trying to kill Salazzo, while Sonny's impulsive and aggressive nature caused him to lose sight of that out of a desire for retribution. Eventually, Tom actually gets Sonny to stand down and think by explaining how a cop will be accompanying Salazzo at the meeting, and killing a cop would cause all the families to turn against the Corleones. However, Sonny's brother Michael volunteers to meet with Salazzo and is able to convince everybody that killing the cop can be done without causing the Corleones to become outcast.
Tom, wait a minute. I'm talking about a cop that's mixed up in drugs. I'm talking about a dishonest cop, a crooked cop who got mixed up in the rackets and got what was coming to him. That's a terrific story. We have newspaper people on the payroll, don't we, Tom?
Sonny isn't smart enough to have thought of that, but Michael is. Tom is also smart enough to have thought of that, but it's not like he would want to tell Sonny that, since assassinating the cops still poses a major risk. So Michael finally meets with Salazzo.
I hope we can straighten everything out. This is terrible. It's not the way I wanted things to go at all. It should have never happened.
Right off the bat, Salazzo tries to appear guilty. Michael obviously doesn't believe a word out of Salazzo's mouth at this point because his only thoughts going through his head are thoughts of revenge. Anyways, the cop frisks him to make sure that Michael doesn't have a gun. Salazzo makes sure that no Corleone cars can follow Michael by having his chauffeur pull off the drift of the century. Then, they finally make their way to the restaurant that was chosen at the behest of the Corleones so that Michael would feel safe. Salazzo starts talking Italian to make what he's saying to Michael seem more genuine. But Michael isn't having any of this, it's only business bullcrap. He wants revenge. That's the only thing that could possibly be going on through his head as he stands in front of the man who tried to kill his father, forced to listen to his pity routine as he bides his time.
No more attempts on my father's life.
What guarantees can I give you, Mike? I am the hunted one. I missed my chance. You think too much of me, kid. I'm not that clever.
Finally, enough time has passed. Michael asks to go to the bathroom, but Salazzo gets suspicious and makes sure to frisk Michael around the private areas, just in case the cop missed anything. Since the Corleones were told of where the meeting would be held by an informant, they had a gun planted there in the bathroom before the meeting took place so that Michael could assassinate Salazzo. Michael returns with the gun, but doesn't come out of the door shooting, either because he forgot to do that, or he's just too nervous. Either way, it doesn't matter. Once Michael sits down, everything Salazzo is saying becomes a blur. Michael doesn't even seem to hear Salazzo as his eyes stop focusing on him, drifting back into desires for vengeance, until finally. Steel sharpens steel, and Salazzo's cunning and ruthlessness causes Michael to begin his descent into the middle of the family business. So that's pretty much everything that can be said about Salazzo. He is purely driven by business and is willing to break every rule and cross every line to get what he wants. He acts respectful when he needs to, but his attitude can switch on a dime if the situation changes and force needs to be used. He is the type of guy that Vito fears the rest of the families will become, and ultimately Sollozzo is the man that Michael becomes. Even beyond that, his uncanny ability of strength and persuasion make him a villain that brings the main characters to their knees. If not for Michael's unexpected intelligence and sense of vengeance, the Corleones would have had no choice but to accept the deal and Vito would be dead. But I hope you enjoyed the video. I know I did enjoy making it, even if I took longer at making it than I should have. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching. I gotta testify. Come up in the spot looking extra fly. For the day I die, I'ma touch the sky. Gotta testify. Come up in the spot looking extra fly. For the day I die, I'ma test.